couple of hymns this morning. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man the Son, thee will I honor, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Fairer are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the nations, Son of God and Son of Man. Glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that man may die. Crown him the Lord of love. Behold his hands and side. Those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity. You may be seated. We want to wish a happy Mother's Day to all you mothers this morning. We hope that you enjoy the time that you have to share and spend with family this morning. We want to especially welcome our guests this morning. We're glad to have you with us, and we hope you're blessed by the time that you spend with us as we share with you both in song and in spoken word. We hope that the Lord speaks to you this morning. And now we hope that he speaks to you as the choir shares with you a special.
Amen. Thank you, choir. And it is such a joy to be with you this morning and to see each of you. And I do want to wish all of our ladies a happy Mother's Day. Of course, we're here to honor the Lord Jesus Christ, but we also want to honor our mothers and, for that matter, all of our ladies. We're so grateful for all that you ladies do, not only for your families, but for your church family as well. I had the great privilege of being able to see my mom this weekend and got to celebrate Mother's Day with her. And, you know, I woke up yesterday morning in the mountains of North Georgia. It was 48 degrees. And I thought, now why am I going back down to South Georgia where it's 90-something degrees and full of gnats? But I'm grateful to be here with you. This morning I want to invite you to stand as we go to God's Word. I've always found this one particular passage of Scripture in 2 Timothy to just be such a special passage here. And what you have is Paul is celebrating the life of two very influential people in the life of Timothy. Timothy, of course, was like a son to the Apostle Paul. And Paul here is reminding Timothy of the great blessing he had because of his godly mother and his grandmother. And so I want to read out of 2 Timothy chapter 1, starting in verse 3. The Bible says, I thank God whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. And so here, again, the Apostle Paul is just celebrating what Timothy's mother and his grandmother did in his life. They invested in Timothy's life. The greatest thing that they did, and the greatest thing that mothers and ladies you can do, is to invest spiritually in the lives of not only your children, but any that the Lord brings in your path. And so we're grateful for the influence that a mother can have on her family, as many of you could probably give testimony this morning of how your own earthly mother impacted you in your own spiritual walk. So before we pray, I do have a special presentation I want to make, so I'm just going to ask you to be seated. We want to honor two special mothers. Of course, we honor all you ladies today, and again, are so grateful for what you do for us, but we have two moms that we want to single out. Well, maybe I shouldn't say that. I don't want to single out anybody, but we want to recognize this morning. First of all, we want to recognize our oldest mother. And so I'm just going to get right on up there. Do we have any mothers that are 90 plus? I know we do because I've already spanned the crowd. 90 plus. All right, Miss Mary Helen. Any others? Okay, Miss Mary Helen King, we celebrate you today. Amen. All right, congratulations. Okay, and the second mom we want to recognize this morning is a mother with the youngest child. The mother with the youngest child. So do we have any mothers that are proud owners of a child that is 6 months or less? I know we do. Miss Heather Vickers in the back. Heather, how old is the baby? 6 weeks. All right. Okay. So congratulations, Miss Heather Vickers. I appreciate my helpers this morning, and I want to thank Mr. Tommy Bell. He's our resident florist, the master rose gardener himself. So thank you, Mr. Tommy, for blessing these ladies with those beautiful flowers. Well, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this day. Lord, we thank you for your just abundant mercies, your blessings. Lord, we're here ultimately to worship you, to honor you, to celebrate you. But as we worship you, we want to thank you for giving us the gift of mothers. Lord, we thank you so much for all that they do for us, the influence that they have on their families. Lord, I'm mindful that for some today is a difficult day because some are here and they no longer have their mother, or there are some here and they desire to be a mother. But Lord, we know that you're a good God, and we don't always understand the way that you work, but we trust you. Lord, we thank you that in your grace you allow us to freely come into this place and just lift high your name to learn more about you. I thank you for many guests that we have today, and we're so grateful for them. Lord, today I pray for burdens that some are carrying. I know most of us, we walk into the church building and we have smiles on our face outwardly, but sometimes there's things going on inwardly, burdens and struggles and trials and tribulations that nobody may be aware of, but we take comfort in knowing you know exactly where we're at. You're the God of all seeing, and you see us this morning. And so, Lord, I pray that you would comfort the hurting this morning. I pray, Father, for those who are struggling. And Lord, I pray if there are some here today who they've never been born again, they've never come to know you in a personal way, I pray, Holy Spirit, as only you can, that you would open the eyes of the blind today. Lord, I want to pray especially this morning for the young family in our community, this young child who many of us are aware of, the situation, who's tragically, she's no longer with us. We trust that she's in your hands, but Lord, we pray for her family today, and we ask that you would comfort that family. Lord, we love you, and we thank you above all for the good and awesome God that you are, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Is the Lord. adore you.
Seated.
All right. Well, as our kids make their way to Children's Church, I want to invite you to turn back in your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark. Gospel of Mark. I wanted to give the ladies a gift this morning, so I'm going to preach to you the Word of God again. So I hope that honors you. I don't have a special Mother's Day message. I just want to continue going through Mark. You know, the context is everything in this particular section from last week to today and to tomorrow's text. They all fit together. And so I wanted to continue to look at this. So again, we keep the context. As you know, you've heard in real estate, location, 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 right? Well, when it comes to studying the scriptures, it's context, context, context. If you're gonna properly understand the scriptures and interpret the scriptures, you got to keep things in context. And so today, again, we're looking at Mark chapter 8, verses 22 through 26. I want to first read the text, and then we will look at it in detail. Mark chapter 8, verses 22 through 26. The Bible says, "And they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought to him a blind man and begged him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. And when he had spit on his eyes and laid his hands on him, he asked him, 'Do you see anything?' And he looked up and said, 'I see people, but they look like trees walking.' Then Jesus laid his hands on his eyes again, and he opened his eyes. His sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. And he sent him to his home, saying, 'Do not even enter the village.'" A few months ago, I was coming back from Bainbridge. I had dropped Carly off at school, and I was coming back home, and all of a sudden, I heard that dreadful noise when you hear something hit your windshield, and I couldn't see anything. Well, then I got out of the car, and I immediately saw a big crack already starting to form down my windshield, and so I thought, well, you know, no big deal. You see those commercials on TV for Safe Flight, and they make it seem so easy, right? And I thought, well, I've got insurance, no big deal, so I called and got it all set up, and they said, well, it looks like you got a $500 deductible on your insurance, and the total cost of the windshield is going to be $498. So I said, well, that's great. Then I get it all set up, and you know, it's not as easy as they make it seem, because, you know, it's kind of inconvenient to get your windshield replaced and everything. Well, I get it all set up, and the guy comes out, and he fixes the windshield. About an hour later, he calls me down, and he says, I said, how did it go? He said, well, it went good. There's just one problem. And I said, well, what's that? He said, well, sit down in the driver's seat and tell me if you see anything. So I sit down, and I'm looking out of the new windshield. It looks perfectly clear. Everything is wonderful. He says, do you see anything? I said, well, I see a brand new windshield. He said, you don't see the scratch. And I said, no, I don't see the scratch. And he said, right there. And he pointed out, sure enough, there was a scratch. He said, unfortunately, we're going to have to do all this over again. He said, they sent a windshield that had a scratch in it. And our policy is the windshield has to be flawless before we can let you go. So I had to set up a whole new appointment, go through the whole thing again. Today we find in our text a man who was blind, and he could not see what was so obvious to everybody else. This is a unique miracle that is only recorded in the Gospel of Mark. It's a strange miracle. Maybe you already noticed that as we were reading the account of this miracle. It's strange because of the particular method that Jesus used to bring healing to this man's life. The story goes that Jesus actually heals this man in two phases, which seems strange to us because most of the time when Jesus healed somebody, it was instantaneous with a touch or even with a word. But here we find this man's vision is going to be restored through a process. And we'll talk about why Jesus did that. Now again, as I mentioned just a few moments ago, context is everything. And the recording of this story, there is no coincidence with this. That, you know, when the writers of the Bible were inspired by the Holy Spirit, there was a reason why they recorded the events in the order in which they recorded them. Last week we had learned about the warning that Jesus gives to his disciples, and he warns them about the leaven of the Pharisees. And we learned last week that both the disciples and the religious leaders had a problem with their spiritual vision. The Pharisees absolutely wasted the miracles that they had personally seen, and the teaching that they had heard with their own ears. They were not able to connect the dots as to exactly who Jesus Christ was, and the reason was is that they were spiritually blind due to the hardness of their hearts. The disciples, they too struggled in their understanding and comprehension of the miracles. They didn't fully understand exactly who Jesus was. They were slow. They were very dense. They were dull. So they too struggled with their spiritual vision. Now, Mark follows up on the heels of that interaction that he has with the disciples, and he gives this miracle of a man who is healed spiritually. And I just want us to understand from the very beginning of this that there's much more here than just a physical healing. This is a picture of the miracle of salvation and what God supernaturally does in our lives when he opens our eyes spiritually. And so keep that in mind as we go through this and we look at this miracle. What happens in this miracle certainly benefited this man, but the miracle was also designed to benefit the disciples, because remember, we're about a year out from when Jesus is going to go to the cross. He's going to die for our sins. Of course, on the third day, he will rise again, and then he would descend back into heaven, and the disciples would be fundamental. They would be leaders in the early church. And so this last year, Jesus is really pouring into the life of the disciples. He's teaching these men. And so this miracle, while it certainly impacted and benefited the man who was healed, but it also serve to teach the disciples this lesson regarding spiritual sight. Now, as we look at the text, I'm going to break this text down into four different observations, okay? So if you're taking notes, there'll be four divisions. So first of all, the first observation that I want to point out comes in verse 22, and that is this: the condition that required help. There is a condition. A man has a condition here, and he needed help. The location we learn is in a town called Bethsaida. Bethsaida was located on the northeastern shore of the Sea of Galilee. This would have been the area where Jesus had fed the feeding of the 5,000, which, just as a test, on the feeding of the 5,000, were the multitudes who Jesus fed, were they predominantly Jews or were they Gentiles? You're right, they were Jews. Last week, or the week before last, when we looked at the feeding of the 4,000, those were predominantly Gentiles because Jesus was in the region of Tyre and Sidon, which was a Gentile region. So here they are in Bethsaida, and immediately when they arrive here, they encounter this man who is brought to Jesus, and the text says that he's blind. That is his condition. He's blind. Now, what we're going to see is this man was not blind from birth. And I'll point out why we know that in just a moment. But blindness in Jesus' day was a very, very common thing. Now, while it was common, it was something that would have been very, very difficult to have in the time of Christ, to be blind. One of the reasons why it was such a common occurrence is because back in those days, of course, they did not have the hygiene that we had. The harsh elements certainly aided to the reason why many people were blind, and of course they didn't have the medical technology and the medicines that we have today. So it was a common condition, but if you were blind, it was miserable. Without saying, it was physically miserable to just imagine the physical problems that this would cause. Possibly blindness was due to infection, and so if you have infection, there is just I won't go into any graphic details, but you can just imagine what the eyes would be like, the pain, the bugs, and all that sort of thing. Economically, it would be miserable. You were completely at the mercy of society. Blind people obviously couldn't go out and work a trade. Socially, they were considered outcast. And also, like so many illnesses in Jesus' day, if you had this condition of blindness, you were stigmatized. Many people would look at blind people as being under the curse of God due to some kind of apparent sin in their life. They were experiencing blindness as a punishment from God. And so here was a man who had a condition that required help. He needed help to get to the only one who could help him. He had a lot of things going against him, but one thing he had going for him was he had some friends. Some friends who show compassion on this man, and they bring this man to Jesus. By the way, that's the best thing we can do as friends, is to bring our friends to Jesus. They had heard about Jesus. They had heard about the miracles that he had done. Possibly these friends were part of that multitude that Jesus had fed with the feeding of the 5,000. And so they believed that Jesus did all things well. And so while their friend, from a world's perspective, there was no hope for or any type of cure for this man, they believed that Jesus could help their friend. And so this man was helpless, so helpless that he needed his friends to get him to the one who could give him help. Now, let's not miss the symbolism here. If all we see is a blind man physically who gets healed, then we're going to miss the point. There is so much symbolism here. When we look at this man's condition, this is a picture of all of humanity in their natural state, spiritually speaking. It goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Because of our first father, our first parents, Adam and Eve, every one of us are born into a state of spiritual blindness. We are born spiritually blind. Ephesians 2:1 tells us that we are spiritually dead. There is no life in us. We can't see what is clearly obvious. You can't see things spiritually speaking. There's these kinds of people all over the world have 20/20 vision, but they can't see spiritually. They're blind to God. Lost people are blind to themselves. They don't see their true condition as God sees them. And because they don't see who God is, they don't see that God is truly holy. Which, by the way, I love that song, because what is the greatest attribute of God? His holiness. Lost people, they're totally blind to that reality of who Jesus is, that he is completely holy, that he can have no fellowship with sin. Therefore, they don't see their own wretched condition, and therefore they're blind to their need for salvation. So just like this man, lost humanity has a condition that requires help that only Jesus can provide. So that is the condition that required help. Secondly, as we work through the text, in verses 23 through 24, we look at the intervention that provided proof. Jesus here graciously intervenes in this man's life. And his miraculous intervention proved several things about him. And I just want to point these out. So 23, it says that, and he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. The first truth about Jesus that is proved demonstrated in this miracle is, first of all, Jesus is available. Jesus is available. What I love about our Savior is Jesus was never too busy for people. He made time for people. Now, we're in church, right? So that means we all have to be honest. We need to be honest outside of church, too. We understand that. How many of you are... You're just so busy that you just don't have time for somebody? Come on, we're all here. We're all in good company, right? We all have those moments where somebody needs us and we have so many things going on, we just say, you know what, I would love to. We say that, right? I would love to, but I just can't do it right now. We're limited. But Jesus always had time. Jesus is available. And I don't know what you might be facing right now. Today's Mother's Day. Maybe some of you are struggling. Maybe you're struggling as a mother and you just feel so inadequate and you're struggling. Jesus is available. You come to Jesus with those burdens. Maybe you say, Lord, I want to be a mother so bad. He hears your heart. He is available. Not only is Jesus available, Jesus is compassionate. He is compassionate. We see the compassion of Christ yet again demonstrated in this miracle. What does he do to this man? He takes this man by the hand. Now, I like this because this man would have been a social reject. Nobody wanted to touch this man. Many people viewed this man under the curse of God. He's not clean. You don't touch hurting people. But Jesus takes the man by the hand. He doesn't stay at a distance from this man. I mean, he could have very easily, he's God, right? He could have told the man, all right, now you stay 50 feet back, and he could have spoke a word to this man and brought healing into this man's life. But no, he interacts with this man, and he leads the man out of town. Now, the text does not tell us why Jesus takes the man out away from the multitude. We don't know. We can speculate. This was not the first time that we saw Jesus kind of doing this. When we looked at the healing of the deaf man back in chapter 7 and verse 31 through 37, you see the same kind of interaction where in chapter 7, verse 33, it says he took him aside from the crowd privately. again, we can only speculate as to why Jesus did that, but there's a personal touch here. He is developing a personal interaction with this man. We don't serve a far-off, distant God. We serve a God who wants to relate to us personally. Jesus is available. He is compassionate. But something else we see in this intervention, this miraculous intervention, is that Jesus is able. He is more than able. It says that he takes the man by the hand, he takes him out by himself, and he puts saliva into this man's eye. Again, he is communicating to this man that his power would bring healing to the man. And he puts his hands on him, and he says, "Can you see anything?" And the text says that the man looked up and said, "Well, I see people like trees walking." Now there's the proof that this man hasn't always been blind, because obviously he had, at some point, he had seen what people looked like and he'd seen what trees looked like. Again, this is very unique, but the point is that Jesus is able, he's able to handle this man's condition, and Jesus is able to make the blind see. Spiritually speaking, the Lord is the only one who can turn the lights on. Lost humanity, spiritually speaking, they are in total spiritual darkness. And until the Holy Spirit comes into that dark room and turns the lights on, they will remain in their spiritual blindness. Let us be compassionate towards lost people. So often as Christians, we get frustrated with lost people because of what lost people do, but lost people do the things that they do because they're lost, and they don't even understand that they're lost because they are in total darkness. But when the Holy Spirit comes and He is able, He can turn on the lights to the darkest heart, and He can illumine the eyes. And today, I don't know, again, what your need is, but Jesus can handle your need. He is available, He is compassionate, He is able. And the ultimate proof that this intervention provides us today, and for the audience, the original audience of Mark, is that Jesus is God. That's the only, this is ultimately why Jesus performed the miracles that He performed, to prove that He truly was who He claimed to be, the Son of God. Jesus is God. Make no mistake, He was a great teacher. Yes, He was. But Jesus was the very Son of God. The intervention that provided proof. Number three, in verse 25, I want to note the restoration that illustrated truth. The restoration that illustrated truth. There's an important spiritual truth that we see here illustrated. We see this two-phase miracle. Again, this gets back to the strangeness of this miracle. Normally, Jesus would just touch somebody and instantaneously they would be healed. Or He would speak a word and there would be instant healing. But in this situation, we note verse 25, well, back up to the miracle. He initially puts His hand on the man. He puts saliva in the man's eyes and there is a partial restoration. But then in verse 25, He lays His hands on His eyes again, and He opened His eyes, and His sight was restored, and He saw everything clearly. There's no longer any vagueness. Now He's seeing completely clear. So there's this two-phase miracle. He receives the second touch. The second touch, after the second touch, He sees perfectly. He has more, His vision is even more clear than 20/20 vision. Perfectly cleared. And so what is going on here? I mean, was Jesus tired and He was just kind of running low on power that day and He didn't estimate properly how difficult this man's situation was and so He had to give it a second try? I mean, is that what's going on here? Well, I'm grateful to tell you that's not what was going on here. Jesus could have immediately restored this man's sight to perfect vision, but He doesn't. He's not struggling. He does this on purpose. Again, this was done to teach the disciples a very important lesson, and for you and I as well, and believers in Jesus Christ. Remember the context of the story. The disciples, at this point, they had eyes to see. They had miraculously been born again. Their eyes had been opened to the truth of who Jesus Christ was. But yet, they still struggled in their spiritual sight. They struggled to comprehend. They didn't have full clarity, so to speak, as to the exact identity of Jesus. And so they needed to grow in their spiritual understanding. Their spiritual eyes still needed to be further opened, if you will. And so the lesson that he was teaching them was that spiritual insight and clarity doesn't come instantly, but it comes gradually over time. And next week's text, we're going to see that the lights begin to come on even further and brighter for the disciples, as one of the particular disciples is going to give a clear confession of exactly who Jesus Christ is. And then finally, the fourth observation that I want to make is in verse 26, and that is this: the instruction that demanded obedience. Jesus heals this man. Now he sees clearly. Now this seems so unfair. I mean, what does the man want to do? I mean, you can only imagine. We speculate. He wants to go running through the streets telling everybody that he can see. But Jesus tells him something just the opposite. He sent him to his home saying, "Do not enter the village. Don't go into the village, go straight home. Don't share what just happened with you." Now, why does Jesus do this? Well, some speculate that this was a form of judgment against the people of Bethsaida. Now, we're not going to go to these scriptures, but in Luke and in Matthew, Jesus pronounces a curse on the city of Bethsaida. They had seen and experienced so many of the miracles of Jesus, but their hearts were hardened, and they refused to believe exactly the claims of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, if the miracles that you had seen were done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented and believed long time ago. Of course, Tyre and Sidon, they were not cities made up of Jews. Those were Gentiles. Those were pagans. And so some believe that Jesus was sending this man home as a form of judgment against Bethsaida because of the hardness of their hearts. But I think that this goes along with what Jesus commonly did as far as how he handled his miracles. Remember, Jesus didn't come to be the great miracle worker, to be a spectacle. Jesus didn't come to be a spectacle. He came to be the Savior. He didn't come to establish a big tent revival, a healing ministry. The point of the miracles was to serve a greater, more important purpose, and that was to point people to their need for the Savior, to authenticate who He was. He was the Savior of the world, the very Son of God. And He did not want His most important ministry, that of teaching and preaching the gospel, to be hindered by multitudes and multitudes of people who had no interest in the spiritual teaching but only wanted Jesus to provide them healing. So he tells this man, just go home. Don't go out spreading the word of what has happened to you. All right, so we've seen four observations as we've broken down the text. Now let me take this and I want to give us three applications, okay? Now, in each of these, I'm going to use the word all. Now, let me just from the very beginning, what do I mean by all? All is talking about Christians. Now, not all people are Christians. Only those of us who have been born again, we've been born from above, we've turned from our sins, we've embraced Jesus Christ to be our Lord and Savior, the redeemed. So, number one, recognize that we all have the same but different stories. As Christians, we have to recognize that we all have the same but different stories. Now, let me explain what I mean by this. As Christians, if we are saved today, and you can't be a Christian and not be saved, But as Christians, we all have the same confession. What is absolutely essential to be a Christian is there must be that time in your life where you confess that you have sinned against a holy God, that you've missed the mark, that you believe that you deserve judgment because you've sinned against God, but that you believe and you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. So as Christians, we all have the same confession. There's not many roads that lead to heaven. There is only one way, and that is through Jesus Christ. And so we all have the same confession, but the Holy Spirit got us, each of us there, a different and unique way. Right? Some of you came to that point in your life where you recognized your need for the Savior and you called upon the name of the Lord. Maybe God used some kind of sickness in your life. He brought you very, very low to the point to where the only place you could look up was to God, and you recognized your need for the Savior. Other people, He uses tragedy. Of course, you don't hear this on the news. You think about 9/11, a great tragedy in our country. You don't hear this on the news, right? But how many people came to Christ through that? Lots of people came to Christ because of that tragedy. God sometimes he uses divorce to bring people to that place where they recognize their need for Christ and they surrender to Christ through something as painful as a divorce. Maybe it was through a revival or it was a church service and you were sitting in church and you heard the gospel message and God miraculously opened your eyes spiritually and you called upon the name of the Lord and you were saved. We want to be very careful that we don't put God in a box. He works uniquely and individually in all of our lives. And so don't get misled or don't get confused because your experience is different from somebody else's. I remember when I was a young Christian, I didn't get saved until I was 22 when I was in college, but I was a young Christian and I was loving the Lord and I was growing, but I would hear people tell these testimony stories. And they would say, I remember the day I was sitting in church and I just came time for the invitation and I just felt this hand upon my back. And I felt this hand pushing me towards the altar. And I just knew the Lord was calling me to Himself. And I prayed and I received Christ. Now, some of you may have that. That's wonderful. But not all of us had that experience. And I remember thinking, well, I never felt a hand upon my back. I never heard heavenly music. I heard a testimony of this one lady. She said, the night I got saved, I heard heavenly music. What does heavenly music sound like anyways? You know, we have to be careful that we don't put God in a box. We don't get confused because our experience is different from somebody else's. What matters is do you have that confession? Have your eyes been open to the reality of who you are, that you are a lost sinner, and that there is nothing that you can do to save yourself, but under the grace of God and the illumining power of the Holy Spirit, He opened your eyes to the reality of who you were and to your need for Christ. And so therefore you called upon the name of the Lord. I hope that you know that. You know what? This man will never, he never forgot his story when he came to know Christ. This was a story that he remembered the rest of his days. Could you take a sheet of paper and could you write down on that sheet of paper how you came to know Christ? It's something important that we know that we can see. Number two, recognize that we all experience a gradual restoration. As Christians, we all experience a gradual restoration. Now let me help us understand what I'm saying behind that. As saved people, the moment that the Holy Spirit opens your eyes and your understanding for your need for salvation and you cry out to the Lord, immediately you are born again, your eyes are opened, so to speak. You're saved. You're on your way to glory. But the longer that you and I are saved as Christians, we experience a gradual restoration over time. And so we, as we mature in the faith, we gain greater insight, understanding into God and the gospel and the word. It comes gradually. Hey, I got some good news. Spiritually speaking, the older you get, the better your eyesight gets. You know, I understand today a whole lot more of how desperately I need Jesus Christ. I understand now a whole lot more than when I was 22 years old of what a wretched sinner I am. I understand that more because I've matured in my understanding of things. I'm at a place that is differently than you. Some of you, you've been saved a lot longer than me, and so you have a different depth and understanding and insight into the Scriptures than what I have. But the point is that all of us, if we're saved, we are experiencing a gradual restoring of sight. And the beautiful promise in Scripture is in 1 Corinthians 13:12, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face." What is Paul saying? One day when we see Christ, when He returns, we're going to see things a whole lot more clearly than what we see them now. Okay. Are our ears turned on this morning? Can I say that again? One day when Christ returns, we're going to see a whole lot more clearly. We're going to have so much more understanding than what we have right now. And I don't know to what extent that is going to be. I don't know. I mean, we're going to understand. I don't think we're going to understand everything because we're not God. But we're going to understand a lot more when we are in His presence and we're in glory. And we're going to be able to understand why the hurtful and painful things that we experience in this life, we're going to understand a lot more, and we're going to be able to say, you know what, I get it now. I see what God was doing behind those very painful things in my life. Now I understand why God allowed me to go through those things. And number three, and finally, recognize that we all have a great responsibility. And that responsibility is demonstrated in these friends. They get their friend to Jesus. They recognize their only hope for their friend was Jesus Christ. And every one of us, if we're saved today, whether you are a preacher or a full-time missionary or Sunday school teacher or deacon or just a faithful church member who comes and you serve, we all have the same responsibility to get people to Jesus, to get people to the Lord, because again, we live in a sea of humanity of lostness. And the only way their eyes will ever be opened, the only way they will receive salvation and spiritual insight is by coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. So I just close with a simple question. Do you, just like Jesus asked that man, do you see anything? That's my question for all of us today on this Mother's Day weekend. Do you see anything? I'm not talking about physical sight. I'm talking about spiritual sight. Is there evidence in your life that you see things now that you used to could not see? Today you see how desperately you need Jesus. It's not like we get saved and then we just go on with life and we never need Jesus anymore. No. We need Jesus' mercy and grace every single day. Can you see this morning? And if you can't, perhaps the Holy Spirit is working on you this morning. Don't turn to religion. Don't turn to morality. Don't turn to the fact that you were baptized whenever you were a child. But trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Call upon the name of the Lord and be saved and allow Him to open your eyes. And it's amazing when you get saved and you begin to look around. And you say, how did I not see this before? I remember when I got saved, I was like, wow, this is a whole new world that I never knew existed. And you won't be disappointed when He opens your eyes. Well, let us pray. Father, Lord Jesus, we thank You, Lord. We thank You for the beauty of this miracle. Let us not miss the spiritual truth that you have here for us. This blind man represents all of humanity, lost humanity, blind and sin. But Lord, we thank you that in your miraculous grace, you open the eyes of the blind. There are some that we know that seem to be so hardened. They don't see the most obvious things. But Lord, we know that you have the power. You are able to open the severest case of spiritual blindness. So Lord, we pray for our friends and our family members, our co-workers that give no evidence that they can see spiritually. May we be faithful to in a loving and compassionate way bring them to Jesus. Lord, today if there are some here today and they've never been saved, maybe they claim to be saved, but there's no evidence in their life that they can see spiritually speaking. I pray that you would open the eyes of the blind this morning. Lord, if maybe we just need to come to the altars and we just need to pour our hearts out to you over something that has nothing to do with what the message has been about, but we just need to do business with you. May we have the courage and liberty to do that. We just want to leave being obedient to whatever you lead us to do, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, at this time, I'm going to invite you to stand as we have our final hymn of commitment. If there is something that you are struggling with spiritually and you would like to have somebody take you out and sit down and take a Bible and help you address those spiritual needs, you just come forward and we will gladly provide that for you. Maybe just want to have somebody pray with you. Whatever it is you need to do, just use this opportunity if the Lord leads you to respond to His word and His leading.
Lord Jesus, I long to be
amen. Well, before Brother Jeff Braswell, our Deacon of the Week, closes in prayer, I'm going to ask Brother Adam, I know you're upstairs, but would you mind coming to the platform real quick? I want you to explain to the church family what we have going on out here in the Welcome Center. As Adam is making his way to the podium, I want to give you a possible opportunity if the Lord leads you. You know, before COVID, we were given the great honor of joining some other churches at different times. The churches would provide different individuals who would go into the jail, and once a week they actually have a service, one for the ladies, and they have a time for the men as well. And so some of you, before COVID, you took part in that, where you would just go and you would lead in a devotional or whatever the Lord led you to do. But because of COVID, a lot of things changed. But now they want to start that ministry over again. So if you would be interested in taking part in that, please let me know. Or maybe you would even like to take a leadership role in that and just organize it, where you organize the different volunteers. Whatever. I just wanted to make that ministry available to you. Maybe that's something the Lord will put upon your heart. That is a great ministry, by the way. Sometimes, in order for the Lord to open our eyes, He takes us to a very, very low place. And we don't want to. We talked Wednesday night about redeeming the time, taking advantage of the opportunities that are given to us. And that is a great opportunity to get the gospel out. And I realize that not all of us are called to that, but maybe the Lord puts that upon your heart. And if you would be interested, let me know and I can give you more information. We will not tonight have any kind of Bible studies or anything. In fact, the men completed their Bible study last week, and that was a great study. So today we just want you to spend time with your families. Brother Adam, if you will, come explain to us the numbers and the Bibles and everything that you got going on out here in the Welcome Center.
Yes, many of you know we've had the Bibles. Our graduate Sunday is next Sunday, so we're going to honor. We have 4 graduates, 2 college and 2 high school graduates. So if we haven't had an opportunity, those Bibles are out there just for you to highlight, or there's pens and there's specialty pens for Bibles so they won't bleed through. Just leave a note in the margins. It's a good way for when we send them off to the college graduates, send them off to their jobs or to their higher degrees. And the high school students going to college, it's just a great way for if they're going through their Bibles, they turn to whatever random verse and they see a note from someone at First Baptist Church. And it's just a way for us to encourage them and to love on them from afar. So I know many of you have already done that. You can highlight as many verses as you want. If you have 10 verses, then do all 10. But that's what those are. And then the numbers, some of you have taken some, so hopefully you figured it out. Church camp is coming up for our youth, and feels like just a few weeks. On June 10th, we're leaving, and there is 3 adults, of course, going, but we have 10 students going, and I wish camp was free, but it's not, and so we've had some fundraisers and stuff, and of course, they're paying a little bit of money, but that is just that's a fundraiser, and the way it works is the youth, well, I helped some of the envelopes, the ones that aren't good decorated, I did. The other ones, some of the youth, like, did some of their artistic things on the envelopes. You'll simply grab whatever envelope you want. If you see number 3, then you'll grab envelope number 3, you'll put $3 in it, you'll turn it into a church office, right? If you see the number 75 and you want to, you know, you're feeling Lord need to do that, you grab number 75, put $75 in it, money check, cash check, whatever it is, and turn that into the church office. That's just a way for us to help our students go to camp. You guys are very generous, and so we haven't had to do too many fundraisers because you guys always go above and beyond what we ask. But that's just another way for us to raise money for camp. If there's extra money, we'll just set it aside and we'll save it for next year. But that is what that is. Or if you have an amount that's not on there and you just feel led to give, come talk to me and we can figure that out. But yes, that's just a great way for us to provide for our students to go to camp. And it'll be here before we know it. So if you have questions or if you have anything like that for the parents, next Sunday we'll have at 4 o'clock, we'll have a youth parent meeting. And so if you have anything like that, please come and I'll answer any questions you have. But that is what that is. It's a fundraiser, and so if you have a check, you can just make it out to the church and put youth camp, and the secretaries will get it into the right place. But that is what that is.
What Adam didn't tell you is on the back of every one of those envelopes is the number 100. So that was a joke, by the way, so you can laugh. But we're grateful. I just want to second Adam and your generosity and your support. Happy Mother's Day. I hope everybody has a fantastic day. Remember, guys, ladies cannot cook lunch today. You can make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I mean, you can survive. We want to serve our ladies today and honor them. I hope everybody has a great, great afternoon. Thank you for all of our guests and being with us today. It's been a good day in the house of the Lord. Brother Jeff, would you mind closing us in a word of prayer? And as you pray, pray over our offering as well.
Let's pray.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, and we thank you for the fact that we celebrate our mothers today. We thank you for each and every one of them and the impact that they've had on their lives, on our lives, Father, and the way that they've cared for us. We pray now that as we partake of this offering, Father, we just pray that you would take it, that you would multiply and use it to the furtherance of your kingdom. Father, we thank you so much for taking us through yesterday, and we thank you for the fact that we feel your presence today, and we thank you that tomorrow, Father, that you're already there and you're working that out for us, and that nothing comes as a surprise to you, Father. We pray that you'd watch over us, protect us, keep us safe, and lead us as we leave this place. All these things we ask in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen.